Well, because it was easy for me, because I something I did well, I could earn money. And in fact, when I came back after 2 years, it was partly because she was going to do a lot of traveling that year. She was going to be traveling and concertizing. She didn't fly. She had to do everything by boat when she came to the States. So she had to plan the trips. And she was the first woman to conduct the New York Philharmonic, mm-hmm. actually. So it was because of her schedule, I adding it up, I wouldn't have that many lessons coming up. I actually thought of coming back to New York so I could take lessons with her when she came to New York.
Yeah.
As it happened, after 2 years, I realized it was not easy for my parents to keep me in Paris, in spite of the fact that I didn't pay for lessons. And I also, I met my future wife.
Yes, Joan.
Joan, in the Catskill Mountains.
Yeah.
And somehow I thought, I'm ready to move on with my life. You know, I think I need to start to establish my career. So in fact, I never did go back to Paris as a student, but I had an apartment there that a friend was staying in, and he packed up my clothes, bought a trunk, and sent it all back to me. So I really was planning to go back to Paris.
But now you're the musician in New York City, and I am sure nobody really cared that you had studied with Mademoiselle Boulanger. They wanted to know, what are you doing at the Brill Building?
Exactly right, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, getting started in anything, I think, is not easy.
Yeah.
Certainly in the music, and because my background was in Latin music, and having written for Ray Barreto and Joe Quijano, and playing with those bands, Tito Puente, I was kind of known that way, and I was happy about it. But I knew I'd have to make the transition to what I'd first of all studied. Yeah.
But you started with orchestrating for Give Me the Chord, Son. OC said to you.
Oh yeah. Well, I took one job.
Yeah.
They paid me $100 a week, which was a lot of money for me those days. Mm-hmm. And there was a fella from Arkansas. He was must have been 350 pounds, 6'9". So a huge man, very nice, sweet, gentle man, by the way, for his big frame. And he paid me to run a he wanted to start a publishing company, a record company, and paid me to do this and to write songs. All of that was foreign to me.
Yeah.
Running a publishing company, a record company. So we would sit now and then. We had a little upright piano in the office, and he would lean way down on the piano like this and say, "Chord for me, son."
Yeah.
And I would chord for him, and we'd write songs.
In composing, though, you start writing songs, and the story of Dizzy Gillespie.
Mm-hmm. That was kind of a heartbreak for me, if you want to know the truth.
Yeah, it had to be.
I still feel that.
Yeah.
Many years later, someone introduced, his attorney introduced us, and it was a great opportunity for me to meet the great Dizzy Gillespie.
Mm-hmm.
It was extraordinary to do, and he was very friendly, very warm to me, and we became friends. I would go to his house, we'd play chess, I'd hear his band, with James Moody playing the saxophone. He used to rehearse in Flushing, I think it was, in his basement. And we became friends, and the whole idea was that I would be writing songs for him that eventually he would hopefully perform. So I wrote a number of songs, maybe 10 or 12 songs, instrumentals. And he picked four or five that he really liked, and he said if I would arrange them for him, he'd play them. So I did. I arranged four or five. I heard the band. I heard Dizzy playing my songs, and after a while, he went on the road and he took those with him and he played them all over the country. And then when he came back, this is the part that still resonates within me as being hard to imagine, even though I know I heard it.
Yeah.
He said to me when he got started, he had other people put their names on his material. And he said he expected that here also. And I was like, first of all, I was shocked. But I was very sad about that too, because first of all, Dizzy Gillespie is a fantastic musician. Yeah. He composes great melodies all day long. He improvises great melodies. Well, I was so naive to the business aspect of it, you know. But I didn't think I was right, and I didn't think it was fair.
Who was the person you would say made the difference that brought you to Hollywood and Paramount, where you could park between Henry Mancini and I forget who was on the other side?
Oh, that was the first day I arrived in Hollywood, actually. The person I would say is most responsible was Larry Pierce.
Yeah.
Larry Pierce was the director of my first film called The Incident. Mm-hmm. It was a wonderful black and white film. It took place on a subway car. Two tough guys, Martin Sheen and Beau Bridges, terrorizing. No, excuse me, not Beau, and Tony Visanti terrorizing a subway car. Beau Bridges was a serviceman with a cast in his arm. And these two guys terrorized the car in such a way that the theater actually, some of the theaters that were showing the film at the time actually pulled the film because people got too emotional about it, which is bizarre to think of today. So we did that film. My next film was a picture called Barbarella.
Jane Fonda, Roger Vadim, one of the classics.
It was a classic, and it was a great experience for me. Bob Crewe was a great songwriter, producer of all the Four Seasons records. And Jersey Boys, for example, is all his songs. And he's actually a persona on the screen. He was asked to do that film as a remake of some Italian score that they weren't happy with. And Bob was a great songwriter, but not a film scorer.
Yeah.
I had just done an album with him together, and so I was kind of like, actually the album combined classical music and Latin music and pop, and he turned all those into songs, so it was kind of natural that we worked together.
Yeah.
So he invited me in to work with him, and I did the score, we wrote the songs together, Barbarella. And Paramount Pictures didn't know who this young person was scoring their big film, they didn't know what I was prepared to do, so they sent their music editor, a man named Paul Hager, to work with me, and I really had some experience with film. Mm-hmm. I wasn't known on the West Coast, but I had done documentary films. I was really prepared for this at this point in my life. And then Bill Stinson, who was the head of music for Paramount Pictures, also came out, and so that was they kind of brought the word back about this young fellow working in New York.
Yeah.
Larry Pierce's next picture was Goodbye Columbus.
Yeah,
and that was also Paramount. So. Then, as a result of Barbarella and the incident, I was invited to do Goodbye Columbus. So that's really what brought me out.
Yeah. How did you then get the entree to start doing the theme songs? Because theme songs for TV shows can make or break.
Right. Well, the first television theme song I did was for Wide World of Sports, 1965.
Are they still using it?
I'm not sure the show's on there. I haven't seen it for a long time. But if the show is on, I'm sure it's an indelible part of the show. But I know they use it for at least 30, 35 years, I'm sure of that.
All those residuals.
Well.
Thank you, BMI.
Anyway, that was my first. Yeah. And 2 years later, ABC wanted to try putting a football game on Monday night. They also didn't know if that would have any success. There was no history doing football. They thought women would rebel against this. You know, they wouldn't let their husbands watch. Well, it turned out to be women liked it, too.
Yeah.
So I did that theme. I did the theme for Monday Night Football. When I came out to California, this same Bill Stinson, when I finished my work on Goodbye Columbus, he said, we have a new pilot for a new series that we think is a winner. We think it's going to go on the air.
Mm-hmm.
And it's youthful. It's romantic. And we want a contemporary feel. Anyway, that show was Love America Style.
Yeah.
So I did the pilot for that show.
Yeah.
It went